G'day Treadheads, and welcome back. In the previous episode, we covered the construction of the Belt Actuator T-Arms. So now it's time to move on to the next stage, and that is the construction of the Actuator Rollers. Even though this subject has been covered in a previous series, there has been some changes and improvements made to the roller assemblies, but the basic construction methods remain the same. So in order to maintain the continuity of this production, I shall include part of this episode up to the point where the changes are made. Let's look at the parts we'll need to make up this fella. We have a bearing with a inside diameter of 12 millimetres and an outside diameter of 32 millimetres and is 10 millimetres thick. It's a reasonably good quality bearing. It's going to have to take a fair bit of load, so make sure you get good quality ones. I have two washers, 21.6mm inside diameter and a 44mm outside diameter and 3mm thick. I have two larger washers with an inside diameter of 27mm, outside diameter 53 and it is 3.5mm thick. First off, let's look at the two outer washers. If you look closely, you will see that the outer flanges are tapered back at 15 degrees to form a V-shape. This allows the belt to be guided in against the roller flanges. If you don't have access to a lathe, there's an easy way that you can actually turn the bevel. So what you need to do is take one of the smaller washers, place it central on the larger washer, and scribe a circle all the way right round. This will be our guide to stop the bevel at that point. Now, to be able to turn these evenly, what I've done is I've made up an arbor consisting of a 5/16 bolt with various size washers that I've either bored out or turned down to fit. And what happens is you place the larger washer over the core of the arbor, rests against the inside of the washer. Another larger washer to clamp that in place, and with a nut that can be then tightened firm. This is fitted into the drill and then turned against my bench mounted face sander. Have a look at these pictures. With the fence on my bench sander adjusted to 15 degrees and the arbor mounted into the drill chuck, I then turn on the sander and with a steady pressure grind off on the washer until the inside of the bevel touches the etch line on the face of the washer. I then take the drill and just lightly clamp it in the bench vise. I first off use a fine cut file to smooth off any of the rough bits and also rad off the outside of the bevel to approximately about 1mm. Following that, I use a medium grade emery cloth to remove any scratches, followed by a fine grade wet and dry to polish it up. There you go, nice and smooth, polished up. Very simple, very easy, only takes you a few minutes to knock one up. Just remove that from the arbor, and there I have the two outer guide flanges made. Now here you can see that the units have been bolted together. The trick is to be able to get it so that the bolts are resting against the side of the bearing to keep that firm, and will then pull all the flanges together and hold it tight. To do that, to get them all lined up, I've made up a drilling jig. Very simple arrangement, just a block of wood with a half inch bolt. Made up two washers that I have bored out and ground down so that they will fit over the half inch bolt and rest inside the outer guide flange. One has already been bolted to the base. What I do is I just place the flange over that central washer with the bevel uppermost. Next I take the two smaller washers, place those together, and they will fit over the nut. Now this nut happens to be 21.6 millimeters, which will make it fit nice and neat inside the washers. I then place the other outer flange there, and another washer fits over and locks that in. So now I have all the washers lined up. On top of that, I have a plate with three holes drilled into it at the precise centres that I require, with a nut welded onto the top to secure the whole tank. This is then tightened down tight so as not to move, and then on the drill press I've now got my guide to drill holes all the way right through all these layers. There we go. Now just remove the parts from our jig, clean up any burrs on the drill holes, and then insert the bolt from one of the outer flanges. Then the inner roller flange then slips straight over the top of that. Next up, just place the bearing in.
Okay, now let's take a look at where the changes have been made. The first change that I made was to replace the 1/8 inch bolts with 5/32 inch bolts. The reason for this change was due to the threads resting against the bearing, the tips of the threads would be squashed, resulting in a loose instead of a firm fit against the bearing to hold the flanges true. By using a slightly larger bolt and filing off that portion of the thread that comes in contact with the bearing has solved this problem. For the location of the holes in the drilling jig, you can use these dimensions for a fairly accurate guide. The second modification to the rollers was to fit a piece of steel tubing between the outer guides to provide a more efficient race for the chain reinforced drive belt. The problem with the earlier type rollers was that there was insufficient contact with the chain, causing it to slip and twist the belt out of alignment, resulting in uneven wear to the V-belt and impaired performance. The simple expedient of fitting a sleeve now allows the chain to seat correctly within the roller. Ideally, it would be best to use tube with a wall thickness of 1.5 millimeters that has an internal diameter that allows it to fit neatly over the internal washer. If you're having trouble finding the right size tube, you can always cut down a larger tube to fit. Here I have used a tube with a 47 millimeter internal diameter that will need to be reduced to 44 millimeters. If you don't have access to a lathe, you can cut fairly accurate rings by first squaring the end of a piece of tube on the bench sander, then scribe a line at 16 millimeters and cut proud of the line. Now comes the tricky bit, where you'll need to hold the ring square and true to the face of the sanding disc. The easiest way to do this is to use another piece of the same diameter tube with an internal sleeve welded in place that will hold the ring firm, thus giving you a piece of tube that is long enough to rest against the sanding guide that will enable you to squarely face back the ring to the etched line. You will notice that the seam inside the ring is in line with the gap on what I call a facing jig. Having the ring in this position will ensure that it sits true to the long axis of the facing jig. I used a similar jig previously in the production of the teeth for my cogs and other parts that require small lengths of tube to be cut and faced accurately. Once you have squared the ring back to the line, leave it in place on the jig and carefully cut the ring through the seam. Now you can place the washer within the ring and squeeze it so it conforms to the circumference of the washer, then scribe a mark on the overlap, then cut away the excess. Now file the cut in square so that they meet when clamped around the washer. If at this stage you find you have a slight gap, place a piece of wire or thin rod to take up this space. Here I have used a piece of MIG wire to fill the gap. It is important to make certain that the gap is closed before you tack weld the join. Otherwise, it will contract when the weld cools, preventing the other washer from fitting inside the ring. Also at this stage, check to make certain that the inside of the washer has sufficient clearance to rotate free of the axle nut. If not, you can always knock the corners off the nylock to give the necessary clearance. Once you've done that, you are now ready to assemble the roller in this sequence. The retaining bolts are trimmed about 2 millimeters proud of the nuts, then splayed over with a tap hammer to firmly secure the entire assembly. With the completion of all four rollers, you are now set to mount them to the T-arm with a high tensile bolt that has been tightened in place with a washer and nut. The washer is used to set the center line of the roller with the center line of the pulley, which should be as close as possible to 14.2 millimeters from the face of the T-arm. Now it's just a matter of slipping the rollers in place and tightening down the nylock nut. Also, you will need to trim the bolt back to the line of the nut to provide clearance between the pulleys. The next thing to do is to install the spur to the trunnion, sliding it until it rests hard up against the outside face of the T-arm, then install the belt actuator back into the transmission frame, and set the actuator mechanism back to its neutral position as you've done before. Now with the T-arm held firmly in the neutral position, scribe an arc following the circumference of the pulley onto the face of the T-arm. This will now give you an accurate reference point for setting the neutral position for the belt actuator assembly. The next stage is the fitting of the neutral return spring to the spur. You will need to use a spring that is strong enough to hold the weight of the T-arms and rollers in the neutral position. Next up is the installation of the tensioning bolt. If you wish, you can purchase a commercially made eye bolt for this job, or make your own to suit your needs. I prefer to make my own by welding a tab to a length of 1/4 inch threaded rod, which is then located through the pre-drilled hole at the rear top of the transmission frame and temporarily held with a normal nut with the spring under slight tension and the spur standing vertical. The next step is to set the position of the spur in the correct position by first clamping it to the T-arm, then raise the arm to the neutral position and tap the spur forward until the T-arm balances in neutral. When you are satisfied that the spur is in the correct position, you can now tack weld it firmly in location. A firm tack weld at two points is all you need at this stage. By this time, you will have noticed that the tensioning bolt and the spur are offline. The reason for this is to impart a slight lateral tension to hold the lever collar firmly against the trunnion mount to hold the trunnion in place. Finish up by replacing the nut with a nylock to hold the tension setting to enable the belt actuator to be tuned to the correct alignment. Well, there you go, fellas. Your belt actuator's completed and installed, and ready for our next episode on the construction and fitting on the segmented chain-reinforced V-belt, as well as the redesigned belt keepers.